Hey guys, so if you're new here, or if you're not, if you want to hear me voice act, head over to our main channel, links down below. And if you don't, this channel's solely for TTS. If you want to know all the details about what's going on, we have a stream up that you can go and watch, but let's just get into the video.
Magic items. The various magical items found in Dungeons & Dragons. Some of these can be rather mundane, while others are priceless artifacts of great power. Airship. Airship refers to two types of flying machine, both popular in fantasy works. In the real world, an airship is a lighter-than-air vehicle with a rigid frame that gets its low weight by being filled with helium, expensive, subject to trade embargoes, hydrogen, even lighter and cheaper, but highly flammable, or hot air, used in balloons since the 1780s but not airships till the 1970s. And can propel itself with some kind of force, typically a propeller. Their practical use was largely restricted to the time period between the start of the First World War and the 1937 Hindenburg disaster that scared people away from airships, with World War II's rapid development of heavier-than-air aircraft putting the final nail in their coffin. Their only practical use since has been their virtually non-existent minimum speed, which is based on local atmospheric conditions, that allows them to see, observation, and be seen, advertisement, for long periods of time with minimal fuel use. Since they were only used for a relatively short period of time and look pretty cool, while making pretty explosions if filled with hydrogen, urban fantasy loves using them to demonstrate a work is set in the interwar period, and or alternate history where the airship lasted longer. In high fantasy, an airship is a sailing ship that, instead of, or in addition to, sailing, flies by magic or quasi-magical science. Since making something so non-aerodynamic fly is blatantly implausible, it's typically a mark of a civilization that is highly advanced magically. Crimson Skies. Crimson Skies is a setting created to facilitate air pirates and prime example of airships as part of alternate history into war. Airships serve the role of carrier to heavier-than-air craft, an expansion on a handful of experimental ones in the real world. Ibaron. Ibaron's airships take elements of both types, with the aesthetics of high fantasy airships, befitting of Ibaron's possessing wide magic to the point it's a science, but serving much the same role as an urban fantasy airship, befitting of Ibaron's interwar influences. Constructed of sawwood, and naturally lighter than air wood, and propelled by a bound elemental, they were created during the last part of the last war, less than 10 years before the standard starting point, by House Lirinda with the aid of Zalogo's elemental binders. The bound elemental requires the captain have the mark of storm, which almost entirely limits them to being controlled by Lirinda, and while foundlings and excoriates exist, they are still built exclusively by Lirinda. The existence of airships is quite a concern to House Orion, as it threatens their monopoly on travel that their mark of passage has ensured them till relatively recently. To deal with this, they've been making greater research into reducing the cost of teleportation and making airships that don't require elemental binding, or, at least, will work for the mark of passage like the Lightning Rail does. An obscure web article actually confirms the possibility of making airships that will work for anyone, as it includes one that is an artifact of the long-lost giant civilization. Final Fantasy. While it's a video game, Final Fantasy is getting noted here because its depiction of fantasy airships is a major influence on how virtually anything uses them. Looking like a normal, wooden, sailing ship with propellers on top and a few behind, and in many games actually being upgraded from such ships. In most games these vessels are exceptionally rare artifacts from ancient civilizations or recently constructed masterpieces by the local mad scientist whose name is always Cid. They are typically obtained by the party during the mid-game and allows nearly free travel of the world map, with few obstacles able to stop it. Forgotten Realms. Halruan skyships are a magical wonder created by the Halruan. Like any other useful object in Toril, despite their method of creation being now widely known, they don't actually have any effect on the world despite just being magic items any sufficiently powerful wizard could make and several governments are described as having commissioned. Mystera. Long before the Forgotten Realms, Mystera was crawling with flying ships of various makes, models and origins, mostly connected to the various megacracies of Mystera, such as Glantry and Alphatia. The most prominent user of airships is the Kingdom of Floating R, a megacracy who happened to live entirely on a nation made up of Earthmotes. The airship Princess Ark was the center of the voyage of the Princess Ark. You can find a fan-made list of all the known airships mentioned in Mystery Products here. Pathfinder. Airships are given stats in Ultimate Combat. They're essentially a giant hot air balloon that's lighter than air via alchemy, with a wooden platform attached under it and propelled by an unspecified but large magic device. They can carry 30 tons of cargo, compared to the 50 tons of a Viking-style longship and 150 of a proper sailing ship. Airships would later appear in one module set in Alkinster, a land where magic is fucked up and technology is higher to compensate, but their existence there is pure window dressing and only serves to describe how the PCS get from point A to B with no encounters and gives no details on them, though the presence of dedicated docks for them indicates they are at least reasonably known within the country itself. The setting already established that Alkinster is very jealous of its guns and its agents seek to destroy foundries elsewhere, so there's at least an excuse for why these aren't elsewhere. An airship Tilicid has been released, based on the description from Ultimate Combat. The only official use of it has been some organized play scenarios set on the elemental plane of air, which imply the ships used are a different kind of vessel that only works on that plane. Any item is capable of being made into an animated object if the creator is sufficiently powerful, and any animated object can have flight selected as an option. The potential to use this for an airship has not gone unnoticed by fans. Come second edition, a ship is outright the example given for a colossal animated object. Spelljammer. Spelljammers are essentially high fantasy airships taken to the next level, as they are now capable of not only flying around in the atmosphere, but actually breaking orbit and flying between planets. Indeed, jammers are so much more powerful than standard D&D airships that their price range is astronomical, and justifiably so. An AD&D splat book for the Forgotten Realms, Inside Raven's Bluff, has a pair of wizard brothers who own a major helm, which their father spent the vast majority of their inheritance on. For a major helm, even suborbital cargo runs would be a waste of potential. And what do these two geniuses do? They use the Ravenster to haul a circus around a portion of one continent. Oh, and sometimes to go for moonlight cruises to impress the ladies. Anyone who knows the first thing about spelljamming who finds out about these two invariably goes something along the lines of "you fucking idiots." A bag of holding is, as the name implies, a bag that holds things. However, due to its magical nature, it holds far more volume on the inside than it appears on the outside and will weigh only a fraction of its contents mass. With it, dungeon delvers and murder hobos can stop worrying about encumbrance rules. Gold coins and D&D used to be 1/10 of a pound, and deny they have a hoarding problem just a little longer. It's explicitly named Bag of Holding for Dungeons and Dragons, but you'll find something similar in any RPG that has magic or comparable system. It's just too damn useful not to have. It may have been made worse by early adventure video games, where you had to collect everything because you didn't know what might be a piece of a puzzle later. Since it is such a common item for adventurers, and breaks physics in a very simple way, it is a lovely tool for gamma breaking. The Necrons love this kinda stuff, what with their Pocket Dimensions and Doors to Infinity, and beyond. They even have a Pokeball for their lords and overlords, if they happen to encounter some dude they just really want to have in the collection. There exists various other iterations of a bag of holding. One of the more common is the Bag of Tricks, which is much more akin to a magic hat, in that it can be used to summon varying types of animals. Another one is the Mirror of Life Trapping, which can automatically nabble you, yourself, for that pocket dimension, ejecting whatever else is in there, probably something equally powerful and, now, grouchy. Feel free to ask your mom about the portable hole. Under no circumstances should you try to put a bag of holding into a portable hole, another bag of holding, or a sphere of annihilation. If you do, horrible things will happen that tend to annihilate everything within several miles. This trope got expanded hard in X-12, Skarda's Mirror, where the eponymous artifact Tear Mirror holds an entire army. Knights of the Dinner Table came to feature a similar item, wherein the ex-retainer Barringer has set up shop and now extorts the knights if they want to store anything more in there. Shit cannon of holding. Let's say you have a bag of holding, £1,500 weight limit. In feudal lands you can easily acquire £1,500 of cattle manure to fill the bag completely. Falling objects in D&D do 1d6 damage per £200 per 10 feet they fall. A falling object will accelerate to 15 meters per second after 40 feet of falling. Remember this for later. A human's normal movement rate in Dungeons and Dragons is 30 feet per round, 6 seconds. If the human took the running feat, they can sprint to 5x their normal movement speed, or 150 feet in one round. With a haste spell in effect, that is doubled to 300 feet in one round. 300 feet 6 seconds equals 15.24 meters per second. So. One guy holds open the bag of holding in outstretched arms, pointing the mouth at some evil wizard. Other guy gets hasted, runs at full tilt at the back of the bag. This will easily invert the bag, violently ejecting its contents at the imparted speed. The target the bag was aimed at will get £1,500 of shit at a nice 15 meters per second. 4, 7.5 rounded up, 8d6 damage, x4 for the extra speed. That's a total of 32d6 of filth applied directly to the forehead, more than the evil wizard's 20d6 max fireball. Average 62 HP of damage, max of 192 HP. No, there is no meta magic feats for maximizing shit damage. No fun allowed section, but the running guy has like 1/7 of the mass of the ejected shit, so it should be traveling at 1/7 the speed even with a perfectly elastic impact. The bag of holding negates mass for the items inside the bag, and the runner is hitting the back of the bag. Laws of inertia are already being ignored before you even open the bag. If you're that upset about it, drop the shit on the wizard from a great height. 1500 pounds of horse shit is like 375 gallons or 1.7 kiloliters of volume, easily enough to bury someone. The weight ratio is not the real problem with this use. First, there is the problem of the fragility of the bag itself. But the rules for this item, if the bag is overloaded or if sharp objects pierce it, from inside or outside, the bag ruptures and is ruined. Per the example above, the running man who is moving at a nice 15 meters per second, does 8d6 damage on impact. Even minimum damage, that is 8 points. Cloth has a hardness of 0 and 2 HP per inch of thickness. That baby is going to tear like tissue and all you'll be left with are some scraps. Second, even if you opened the bag at the listed speed, you would still not get projectile excrement at the same speed. Again, per the rules for this item, if a bag of holding is turned inside out, its contents spill out, unharmed. As was stated earlier, this is magic and the laws of inertia are being ignored. It does not say that its contents spill out at the same speed that it was opened, just that the contents spill out. What is in the bag is motionless and when ejected, is still motionless. It does not gain any inertia from the outside. So, even if you could find a way to protect the bag from destruction, all that would happen is that you would hit the bag and poof front smack into 1,500 pounds of bovine bio-waste. Take 8d6 of damage and onlookers will have to make a will save or collapse in laughter at the sight. This is not to say that hurling tons of manure is impossible by the rules, just not with the bag of holding, at least used like this. Comma, you may want to direct your attention to the shrink item spell. Can you say 20 square feet of flaming cow shit? Commoner, herald of the end. There is a flaw in negative feat that turns any commoner with a bag of holding into a scion of death. Sweet. Chicken Y death. From dragon number 330. Chicken infested, you've got chickens. Effect, whenever you draw a weapon or pull an item out of a container, you have a 50% chance of drawing a live chicken instead. No, we don't know where the chickens come from, it's your character. Let's roll. Sand can be claimed as an improvised weapon. Claiming that one grain of sand is an improvised weapon dealing zero damage, which is a stupid claim as anyone has ever tried to pick up a single grain of sand knows, so this is where it all falls apart. So use a small pebble and claim it as an improvised sling bullet or something. Take the quick draw feat. You may now take pebble sand out of the bag as a free action. You can drop the sand as a free action as well. Draw. If it's sand, drop it back in. If it's a chicken, let it go. One can safely say that there are 50,000 grains of sand in a pound, and 1,500 pounds of sand in a bag of holding. 75 million chickens can thus be produced on the assumption that every grain of sand produces a chicken, which it will in eventuality. If you really want to munchkin it up, use your chicken money to buy a wand of shrink item, create blocks of sand and shrink them at 4,000 times the amount of sand as you crush them to bits. If your DM complains about this, laugh at the foolish fool for letting you get this far. You now have billions of chickens, each taking up about a quarter cubic foot. Crush your enemies. Crush them all. And then laugh as they bow before you and call you Colonel Sanders. Something that comes to mind is that, it doesn't say anywhere that the chicken replaced the item you're meant to draw. This means that, using only one grain of sand or pebble, you can create an infinite number of chickens in an instant and still have your grain of sand. Of course, in that case you don't need a bag of holding, so it doesn't really apply to this article. Blackrazza. One of the most infamous magical weapons in Dungeons & Dragons, Blackrazza is one of the three artifact-tier magical weapons that first appeared in the AD&D 1E module White Plume Mountain, alongside Wave and Whelm. Blackrazza is essentially a ripoff of Stormbringer, the soul-eating demon blade wielded by Elric of Melnibone in Moorcock's dark fantasy sword and sorcery novel series. As such, Blackrazza takes the form of a greatsword with a jet black blade, sometimes described as being filled with star-like glimmers of light. A physical embodiment of nothingness, sometimes stated as having been forged from a dying universe or something along those lines. Blackrazza is a soul-eating blade driven by an incessant hunger for the lives of others, and which compels its bearer to hunt and slay people. This traditionally gives it incredible lethality in battle, and makes it a handy way to circumvent certain unkillable enemies, but it also traditionally has a drawback, namely, it tends to react poorly to attempts to use it on constructs or the undead, usually resulting in the bearer taking damage instead of the target, as its unsated hunger causes it to gnaw at them instead. Blackrazza reappeared in 3rd edition as a legacy weapon, a kind of evolving magical weapon. It then reappeared as an artifact weapon in 4th edition. Finally, in 5th edition, it appeared alongside Wave and Whelm again in the Dungeon Master's Guide section on sentient magic items, and was mentioned as one example patron for the Hexblade patron for warlocks. The Crunch. Having appeared in all 5 editions of D&D so far, Blackrazza has remained surprisingly consistent, given the different ruler sets it's come under. AD&D. As mentioned, Blackrazza first appeared in 1E's S2, White Plume Mountain module. Here, it was a sentient +3 sword with int 17 and ego 16. Its sole purpose was to consume souls. If you refused to feed it, it grew restless, with its ego growing by +1.4 every 3 days of starvation until it was strong enough to take you over and kill a sapient humanoid, whereupon it went back to normal. When used to deliver a killing stroke, Blackrazza ate the victim's soul. Not only did this prevent them from ever being resurrected, but it gave the bearer a number of bonus levels equal to the victim's level, and it gave them hit points equal to the victim's total hit points. This temporary boost lasted for a number of turns equal to the levels received through soul eating. If you used it on any undead that wasn't a ghoul, though, you then lost a level per hit, dying and having your own soul eaten if you lose all your levels, permanently until you either adventured sufficiently, got zapped with restoration, or you killed enough creatures of your own race to receive twice as many levels through the soul eating feature. On top of all that, it could talk both verbally and telepathically, detect any creature with a soul within 60 feet, grant its bearer haste for 10 rounds 1/day, and made them 100% immune to charm and fear effects. The 2E update of Blackrazza came in 2nd edition's Return to White Plume Mountain. Its soul-eating power was pretty much identical to the original, except now ghouls weren't exceptions to the no-stabby undead rule. It was called out as a neutral evil +3 greatsword, and it lost its special traits, sensing victims, haste 1/day and immunity to charm and fear. 3E. After that, Blackrazza and its companions languished in obscurity until near the end of 3.5, what created a free update of White Plume Mountain and hosted it on their website, complete with renditions of the three white plume weapons as weapons of legacy, and a web enhancement called Outside the Mountain, which did the same for the lost weapon of Frostrazer from Return to White Plume Mountain. Alas, when WotC reorganized their website, this free material disappeared into the ether of internet. Except for the fact that Drivethrupg salvaged it, though now charging a buck for its use. But, since TG believes in stuffing that noise, you get to read it here for free, instead. Blackrazer, the legacy weapon, is a former epically powerful soul-eating undead, something akin to an Atropole, that Caractus summoned from another universe and bound into the shape of a greatsword. There are three legacy rituals that a would-be user must complete to unlock all of Blackrazer's powers. In order from least to greater, these are dominating the bleed, spend 1 minute meditating with the blade and then succeed on a DC 15 concentration check. Failure costs you a negative level that is DC 15 to shake off. Opening the soul, gain at least 2 negative levels from an undead of equal or higher CR whilst wielding Blackrazer and don't cure them except by a fortitude save. An exile of the damned. Travel to the negative energy plane and perform an 8-hour long ritual to attune Blackrazer to the plane. In its default form, Blackrazer, the legacy weapon, is a +1 greatsword. Upon attuning to it, it becomes intelligent. Int 13, Wis 10, Char 13, Ego 3, Chaotic Neutral. At level 5, it communicates through empathy, has a personality conflict whenever the bearer tries to use any weapon other than itself, and can see and hear to a range of 60 feet. At level 8, its int and char rise to 16. It becomes capable of telepathic communication, and now has dark vision. Finally, at level 11, it finishes awakening and becomes in CH 18, and with senses, hearing, dark vision, blindsense, to range of 120 feet. Its ego rises more steadily, becoming 4 at level 7, 8 at level 8, 9 at level 9, 12 at level 11, 13 at level 12, 15 at level 13, 19 at level 17, 21 at level 18, and 23 at level 20. As a weapon, it increases in power to a +2 greatsword at level 7, a +3 greatsword at level 12, a +3 vicious greatsword at level 17, and a +5 vicious greatsword at level 20. Finally, it unlocks several unique powers as it levels up. Mental Ward, activated at level 6. This is a +1 bonus to saves against mind affecting effects, which increases to +3 at level 14 and +5 at level 19. Detect Life, gained at level 9. This allows Blackrazer to cast what is essentially a reversed Detect Undead spell 3 times per day. Soul Drinking, Blackrazer's most iconic power. When Blackrazer drops a victim to 0 hit points or below, the bearer can activate a special death knell as a swift action. The victim must make a will save against the higher of Blackrazer's or the bearer's charisma, or be swallowed into the blade. If the creature is undead, though, the bearer gains a negative level, DC 12 plus Blackrazer's char modifier to remove, and the undead gains +5 temporary hit points. If the negative levels kill the bearer, then they are swallowed by Blackrazer themselves. This ability can be used 1/day at 10th level, 3/day at 13th level, and becomes automatic, activating whenever Blackrazer mortally wounds a victim. At level 17. Creatures consumed by Blackrazer cannot be resurrected by anything shy of miracle, true resurrection or wish. Haste, the last of Blackrazer's powers. Upon hitting level 16, the bearer can haste themselves for up to 10 rounds per day. 4E. Come 4th edition, Blackrazer faded into ignominy. Although Wave appeared in the plane below and Whelm appeared in open grave, Blackrazer never received an official retope. Instead, as part of the lead up to issue number 384 for Dragon Magazine, WotC challenged the fans to try and draft up what they thought a 4E Blackrazer would look like. The two winning entrants were featured in the D&D Illumini column for that article. Of course, as that wasn't featured in the issue itself, only those able to navigate the vagaries of the internet's Wayback Machine have a hope of seeing them in the flesh, so to speak. Since TG believes in getting shit done, they track them down for you readers. The first version was done by Zach S. Comma, who refluffed Blackrazer as a shard or emanation from Akuma the Corpse Star, a sapient black hole and one of the possible patrons of Star Pact Warlocks for that edition. A Paragon tier artifact, it was, at its basis, a +3 magicful blade, a sort of super greatsword first introduced in the Adventurer's Vault Gear Sourcebook, with the following properties. On a critical hit, it did +3d6 points of necrotic and cold damage, and it healed the bearer as if they'd spent a healing surge. All damage inflicted with Black Razor is treated as being necrotic and cold damage. It acts as a warlock implement for warlocks on the Star Pact. Once per encounter, it can sense the presence of all living, non-undead, non-construct creatures within a 12 square radius, that's 60 feet. Finally, when used to kill a non-minion creature of Paragon tier or higher, it gives the bearer a boon based on the type of creature. An aberration dazes the wielder until the end of their next turn, but gives them +4 will until the end of the encounter. An immortal grants the bearer resist 5 to all damage until encounter's end. An elemental temporarily stokes Black Razor's power, meaning it now inflicts ongoing damage, 5, with each strike, a state that lasts until the encounter's end. A phase soul gives the bearer a supercharged surge of energy, granting them regeneration 5 until encounter's end. Natural creatures grant the bearer temporary hit points equal to the victim's level. Shadow creatures cause the hungry Black Razor to sap the bearer's soul, costing them 1 healing surge or else inflicting necrotic damage equal to their healing surge value if they have none left. And constructs have no effect at all. This version of Black Razor gains +1 concordance with its first kill of the day and -2 each time it goes a week without being fed. When satisfied, it grants +2 to defenses and saving throws against charms and fear, and gains a daily power. On a successful melee hit, the bearer can suck the victim into Black Razor, causing them to take ongoing 15 cold and necrotic damage. If this kills them, they vanish forever. When pleased, the defense bonus is increased to +4. It becomes a +4 weapon that does +4d6 damage on a critical hit, and it gains a second daily power. Gain +4 to speed and +1 attack with Black Razor each turn until the end of the encounter, at the cost of always having to move towards the closest bloodied creature. On the other hand, if unsatisfied, it drains 2 healing surges from the bearer at the end of each extended rest and inflicts a -2 penalty on all rolls that aren't attacks with Black Razor. And if you anger it, oh boy, it drains 4 healing surges from you after each extended rest, and then saps a healing surge per round that you hold it. When you lose all your healing surges, you die and become a slaughter white driven to carry it to battle. Needless to say, this version of Black Razor is a cursed weapon, and like other artifacts in 4e, it doesn't move on, and you need to use a remove curse ritual to be rid of the blasted thing. Why? Well, if not for the need to constantly feed it, then because Maws of Akuma and various undead nasties will be after you constantly to take it from your cold, dead fingers. The second version, done by Christopher T. Comma instead makes Black Razor a sliver of the elemental void discarded by the primordials that became the Shadowfall. This version is a Paragon tier artifact with the base stats of being a +3 magic greatsword. It does +3d6, +3d12 versus bloodied, necrotic damage on a critical hit, grants the bearer proficiency in its use, and of course has the usual bonus for eating souls, punishments for attacking the undead tray. In this case, Black Razor grants temporary hit points equal to the bloodied value of its victim when it devours the soul of a living victim. On the other hand, if you attack an undead creature with it, it drains you of health equal to your healing surge value, takes 1 healing surge, or leaves you weakened until you take a short rest, if you have none left, and heals the creature by giving it temporary hit points equal to your lost hit points. And if this kills you, then you're dead permanently. It also gives you the ability to sense all souls within a 20 square, 100 FT, burst at will, and lets you take a standard action as a free action 1/day. This version of Black Razor is far more complicated to keep happy. It loves an amoral or evil wielder, +2 concordance, gains +1 concordance with the first kill of each day, but gets pissed off, -1 concordance, if the bearer uses a weapon other than Black Razor, or goes too long without feeding it, -1 concordance per 3 days without feeding, is seriously pissed off, minus 2 concordance, by entering the Shadowfall or being taken up by a goodly priest, and isn't too happy if you keep it in the Shadowfall, minus 1 concordance per day in the Shadowfall. When satisfied, it grants plus 2 to will defense versus charm and fear, plus 2 to saves versus charm and fear, plus 2 to initiative. You can now benefit from its hasted action 1/encounter instead of 1/day, and can gain plus 2 speed for the rest of the encounter once per day. When pleased, it becomes a plus 4 weapon that does plus 4d6, plus 4d12, bonus damage on a critical hit. It grants plus 4 to will defense versus charm and fear, grants immunity to charm and fear effects, grants plus 4 initiative, lets you use a single encounter or wretchage power from a creature whose soul you eat, can recharge the aforementioned hasted action by devouring souls, and its daily speed boost power grants plus 4 speed. An unsatisfied black razor strips you of its hasted action power, whilst if you anger it, it downgrades to a plus 2 weapon that tries to dominate you once per day, cumulative minus 1 penalty to the save throw each time, in order to make you kill the nearest victim. Upon being fed, it calms down and restores its concordance back to 5. When it moves on, a satisfied black razor grants the former bearer a permanent plus 5 bonus to saving throws versus charm and fear effects. If unsatisfied, however, it vanishes in the middle of the next fight, stealing bloodied value hit points and a healing surge in the bargain. 5e. In 5th edition, meanwhile, Black Razor moved up in the world by being part of the Dungeon Master's Guide alongside Wave and Whelm. Poor Forgotten Frost Razor was left out again. The 5e version of Black Razor is a plus 3 intelligent magic greatsword which will only allow non-lawful characters to attune to it. In 5e, its iconic Devour Soul power is treated this way. When you kill a non-construct with Black Razor, it eats the creature's soul. Not only does this prevent the creature from being revived by anything short of a wish, it grants you temporary hit points equal to the victim's maximum HP for 24 hours, during which time you also have advantage on attack rolls, saving throws and skill checks whilst you have Black Razor in hand. Killing multiple victims doesn't stack the bonus, it just resets the clock. However, if Black Razor strikes an undead creature, you take 1d10 necrotic damage and the creature is healed for 1d10 hit points. If you drop to 0, your soul is eaten. It also has the Soul Hunter property. You can sense the presence of any tiny or larger non-construct, non-undead creature within 60 feet. You are immune to charm and fear, and can cast a haste spell on you 1/day. If it does, Black Razor sustains the spell for you, so you don't need to make a concentration check. This Black Razor is chaotic neutral with int 17, wis 10, char 19, and coherency, with dark vision, to a range of 120 feet. Black Razor only cares about getting fed, so it provokes a personality conflict if you go 3 days without feeding it, making its complaints felt at the sunset of the 3rd day without a meal and each day thereafter until fed. Rural is a great app available on the Apple and Google Play Store as well as desktop for creating beautiful 8-bit character art. The app has 14 supported races, 150 plus weapons, 400 plus armor pieces for you to mix and match, 20 plus mini bases. There is that much to work from. I was able to make Coldsteel the Hedgehog, the God Emperor of Mankind, Pepe, and they are always adding more artwork. The app also has a character sheet to help keep track of everything during games. And if that wasn't enough, you can play about with the app for free with limited artwork. So go ahead, check it out, and if you decide to buy the app, use promo code NICKBEARDIA for 10% off and it lets them know we sent you. It's a great sponsor and a great app and we hope you guys go ahead and check it. But let's get back to the video. The Codex of the Infinite Planes. The Codex of the Infinite Planes is a Dungeons & Dragons artifact hailing from the White Box supplements. It then went on to appear in the AD&D 1E DMG, AD&D 2E Book of Artifacts, D&D 3E's Epic Level Handbook, and D&D 4E's Mordenkainen's Magnificent Emporium. It also appears in Pathfinder's Artifacts and Legends. Throughout its appearances, the Codex remains firmly defined. This massive book of inscrutable origins holds many powerful secrets relating to planar magic. Secrets so powerful that even opening the book can be potentially deadly to a would-be user. Whilst details have fluctuated over the editions, its basic themes revolve around the ability to teleport users throughout the planes, enhancing their magical abilities, and access to various conjuration spells, though always at a steep and probably deadly price. And there's no index or table of contents, per David Z. Cook. Although maybe some madman has jotted fragments of such, in some secondary work, that's up to your DM. Close bracket. E. Gary Gygax stuck it into Greyhawk lore in, interestingly, his Dungeon Master's Guide some years before the noobs had the Greyhawk boxed set itself. It was tied with the Nidhive region, maybe even before the Invoke Devastation. Later, a higher level wizard named Tsunk used it to take over the City of Brass. That illustrates just how awesome this book is. Although, let's just say that Tsunk is probably not the master of the Efreet Madden today. All in all, if you find the Codex of the Infinite Planes, it were best not to use it. 2E. Zeb Cook delivered a codex to 2E's Book of Artifacts. Because of you know who, the Greyhawk specific lore is abstracted out. But, because of staff resistance to her misrule, it is heavily referred to, down to the Yagrix tome reference. Cook advises that this book is a plot device, so not something the party should have long access to. Putting teeth into this, each page read adds a 1% cumulative chance of triggering an awful fate. And yes, the little three words are invoked no saving throw. 3E. Appearing in July 2002's Epic Level Handbook, thus entering the 3.0 OGL, Andy Collins and Bruce R. Cordell lived up to the Codex's legacy. For them it is a major artifact that has been in the Brass City. They note Yagrix but not Tsunk. Opening it up for the first time will hit you with destruction, DC 30 for 10d6 damage. If you fail, you turn to dust. If you manage to survive this, you get to study its infinite pages for great knowledge and power. At a risk. After a day of study, you can roll a DC 50 spellcraft check to see if you learned something new. If you don't make the roll, you get +1 to your next one. You can learn quite the list of powers. Who once known you can use at will. Astral Projection, Banishment, Elemental Swarm, Gate, Greater Planar Ally, Greater Planar Binding, Plane Shift, and Soul Bind. Powers are learned at random. But the risk is always there. Every day also requires a DC 30 will save or you go insane, as per Insanity. Actually using a power is risky as well. You need both a concentration and a spellcraft check with a DC 40 plus double the spell's level, making it 50 at its lowest and 58 at its highest. If you fail, you roll a percentile dice to decide your fate, get hit by an earthquake and storm of vengeance spell, summon 1d3 plus 1 balers, pit fiends or similarly powerful evil outsiders to mess you up, have your soul put in a gem, as per trap the soul, and your body entombed somewhere, as per imprisonment, both in a random place on the current plane, or utter a wail of the banshee and get hit by destruction every turn for 10 turns. 4E. Oddly enough, in 4E the codex is almost meager. Madam has a bunch of big name artifacts, including the Book of Infinite Spells, the Hammer of Thunderbolts, and the Shadow Staff. Thing is, only a few have a full artifact retoop, with concordance levels and their bonuses penalties. None of those three have one, and neither does the codex. The Codex is an epic artifact, a wondrous item rather than a tome implement, with two daily powers. One banishes a target from another plane, but on a miss damages the user and target, and causes the user to be stunned for a turn. The other takes you and your friends to anywhere on the planes that you name, or even provide a vague category or description for, like an Archdevil's treasure room or a safe place with friendly people. You then have to pass an arcana check, or suffer a disaster of the DM's choosing. Pathfinder. Because it appears in the SRD, Peizo decided to use it as well. It works more or less like its 3E equivalent, except the you done fucked up chart is expanded to 2 dozen results of a varying number of do not want, from having 444 Shinigami show up and try to murder people to being hit by energy drain or reincarnate every day, grow to 65 feet in size and gain 5 feet every day, having everyone around you turn alignment, get hit by a series of meteor swarms, a zombie apocalypse starts and others. And since the Codex is a book, this means that it's a legal target for a Tome-eater archetype occultist to devour. The text is a bit murky as to if eating a book constitutes tearing out its pages, but if given the opportunity to do so, you should totally do this, if only to see your DM's face when you tell him you want to eat the Codex of the Infinity Planes. Crown of Corruption. The Crown of Corruption is an unholy Jathayanki relic in Dungeons & Dragons. Serving as the crown of Vlarkith Kalvidar, who created it more than 900 years ago before the present, it is an artifact, a magical item that is the key to her maintaining control over the Jathayanki. Gaz 13, the Shadow Elves, had a Crown of Corruption before all that. It made you a lich if you put it on. So, don't do that. Close bracket. The Crown of Corruption appears as a slender, black and silver diadem, with rubies on its spires that look eerily like flickering eyes and which is reputed to occasionally twitch of its own volition. It grants its wearer the ability to cast the spells Energy Drain, DC 23 Fortitude Save to Negate, Mass Suggestion, DC 19 Will Save to Negate, and Control Undead, DC 20 Will Save to Negate, at will. Additionally, by touching the corpse of a creature slain by the crown's energy drain attack, the wearer can enact one of the three rituals inherent to the crown, any one of which requires 10 minutes to complete. The rituals of the Tlaketh and the Kryzeth transform the creature into one of these unique undead creatures. The rituals can be performed on any dead humanoid or outsider, but Vlarkith Kalvidar only uses these powers on her Jathayanki subjects. The Ritual of Death Sigil liquefies the corpse into a congealed ectoplasm that serves as powerful reagent in magical rituals. The Death Sigil from a corpse can pay towards 100 XP per HD of the original creature when used as part of making an item or casting a spell that is fueled by experience points. This artifact has only 30 hit points, but can only be harmed by a magical weapon that bears both the holy quality and the disrupting quality. If it is destroyed, then all Tlaketh and Kryzeth created by the crown instantly perish in the bargain. Deck of Many Things. Oh, holy shit. Where do we even begin with this? Well, let's start with the basics. Overview. The infamous Deck of Many Things is a magical item that made its debut in the Greyhawk setting of Dungeons & Dragons. The exact size of the deck, and thus its contents and effects, varies with the edition, but throughout its existence, one thing has remained consistent: its potential for inciting complete and utter chaos with the draw of a card, the likes of which can be generously described as a hazard to the adventuring party, the setting, and the players and DM alike. So how exactly does it work? Well, assuming your DM is foolish, or, alternately, cunning enough to allow you to obtain one, the deck is basically just an ordinary deck of cards, with each card corresponding to a specific effect. Some of the cards have good effects, gain a level, obtain wealth, etc., and some effects are bad, idiocy, getting your soul sucked out, etc. You can choose to draw however many cards you want, but players with at least some sense in them will opt for a small number, as basic probability means drawing a card that will completely buttfuck you increases with each pull. And if you happen to survive your ordeal, you may find that your character's life circumstances are so drastically different that it completely derails the campaign if it hasn't already. Whether it's your character losing every save throw, or turning into a greedy bag of dicks, the wisest option may simply be to just say no. Unless you're definitely going to die, you're much better off avoiding the deck, as typically at least two of the cards will effectively take your character out of the game forever, and many more will set you back tremendously. In short, this is for use by chaotic neutral and chaotic evil DMs only. The very first appearance was in literally the first D&D supplement, Greyhawk, 1975. It then went on to reappear in the first Dungeon Master's Guide, 1979, the second edition DMG, 1989, the Encyclopedia Magica Volume 1, 1994, the 3rd and 3.5 DMGS, Dungeon Magazine number 177 for 4th edition, and the 5EDMG. Cards of the deck. Of course, you can't have a magical deck of cards without each of those cards meaning something, so here's the drill on just what the deck of many things features. Names in brackets list the equivalent cards, so you can emulate drawing from the deck with any standard playing card. This particular set of descriptions applies to the 5e version, for what it's worth. Close bracket. Balance, 2 of spades, your alignment flips to its opposite, e.g. lawful good becomes chaotic evil. No effect if you're true neutral, although you could flavor it as switching between the actively maintaining a balance and ambivalence varieties. Comet, 2 of diamonds, if you beat the next monster or group of monsters by yourself, you get a free level up. Donjon, ace of spades, you disappear into an extra-dimensional sphere, leaving your stuff behind. Divination magic can't find the sphere, but wish can. You are stuck in suspended animation within the sphere until someone pulls you out of it. Lose any further draws. Uriel, queen of spades, you're cursed with -2 to all saves. Only a god or the effect of the fates can lift the curse. The fates, ace of hearts, you can avoid or erase an event as if it never happened. You can trigger this at any point before your death. Flames, queen of clubs, a powerful devil becomes your enemy and will seek to ruin your life before it kills you. This enmity will last until either you die or the devil dies. Fool, black joker, lose 10,000 XP. If that would cause you to lose a level, you keep the exact amount needed to retain it, and draw again, counting both as the same draw. Gem, 2 of hearts. 50,000 GP worth of jewelry materializes at your feet. Idiot, 2 of clubs, permanently reducent by 1d4 plus 1, to a minimum of 1, but you get another draw. Jester, red joker, either gain 10,000 XP or draw 2 more times. Key, queen of hearts, a magic weapon you're proficient with of at least rare rarity appears in your hands. The GM chooses what the weapon will be. Knight, Jack of Hearts, you gain the service of a 4th level fighter of your race, who appears in a space within 30 feet of you. The fighter will serve you for life and is controlled by you. Moon, Queen of Diamonds, you can cast Wish 1d3 times. Rogue, Jack of Spades, a random NPC becomes hostile to you and will remain so unless Wish or Divine Intervention is used. You won't know which NPC is affected until they or someone else reveals it. Ruin, King of Spades, all forms of wealth you have other than magic items vanish. Property, businesses, lands, it all disappears. Skull, Jack of Clubs, a Grim Reaper-esque skeleton appears and attacks, warning your party that you must fight it alone. It will fight you until either it reaches 0 HP, causing it to vanish, or you die. If it kills you, nothing can revive you. If your party ignores its warning, more Grim Reapers show up. Star, Jack of Diamonds, one of your ability scores goes up by 2. This can exceed 20, but can't raise a stat beyond 24. Sun, King of Diamonds, gain 50,000 XP and a wondrous item of the GM's choice. Talons, Ace of Clubs, all your magic items disintegrate. Artifacts vanish, as per the Ranger ability, instead. Throne, King of Hearts, you gain proficiency in the persuasion skill, and you double your proficiency bonus on checks made with that skill. In addition, you gain rightful ownership of a small keep somewhere in the world, if you can clear out the monsters infesting it. Vizier, Ace of Diamonds, at any time you choose within 1 year of drawing this card, you can ask a question in meditation and mentally receive a truthful answer to that question. It can also provide a solution to a difficult problem. The Void, King of Clubs, your soul is removed and imprisoned in an object of the GM's choice, which will be guarded by at least one powerful being. You're incapacitated until you get your soul back, and while Wish can't return your soul, it can reveal where it's being kept. Lose any further draws. Apart from the very first version of the deck, which had 18 cards, the deck of many things have been traditionally divided into two formats, imperfect, 13 cards, and perfect, 22. An imperfect deck lacks the following cards. Vizier. Comet. The Fates. Gem. Talents. Idiot. Dungeon. Balance. Fool. 4E's deck of many things. The 4E version of the deck of many things is a very different beast to its kin in other editions. At its basis, it functions as an artifact grade tome, a special implement unique to wizards, in two differing tiers, a Paragon tier version in Dungeon Magazine number 177, and a Heroic tier version in the Adventure Madness at Gardmore Abbey. Aside from the ability to draw cards and trigger their effects as normal, the Paragon deck is a +5 tome that can also be used by Chaos Sorcerers as an implement. It renders the bearer immune to domination effects, can force an enemy within 10 squares to reroll an attack roll, skill check, saving throw, and take your choice of the two results once per encounter, and once per day, allows you to roll a d20 and swap it in for the roll of an ally or enemy, depending on whether you want them to roll high or low. This version cleverly makes use of 4E's artifact concordance mechanic, making the bearer more likely to draw good cards if the deck likes them and more likely to get the bad cards if it doesn't. There is one particular difference in this version of the deck compared to any others. You only ever get to draw one card from it. Once that card's magic has blessed or cursed you, the deck vanishes from your possession and is gone forever, never to appear before you again. Tarot deck of many things. Featured in Dragon Magazine number 77, the Tarot deck of many things is a tarot deck that grants magical effects when you pull a card from it. Released for Advanced Dungeons & Dragons 1st Edition, this version of the deck of many things has 78 different cards, each of which has at least two different effects, depending on whether you draw it in the upright position or the inverted position. This version was made official when it was reposted in the Encyclopedia Magica, Volume 1. Tiaroka deck of many things. When Ravenloft was upgraded from an adventure module to a campaign setting in Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, part of the background flavor was the creation of a themed tarot-esque deck, the Tiaroka. In 1997, the Cargatane, a fan group supporting Ravenloft and its fandom via an online website, released the first of their semi-official netbooks, The Book of Souls. On page 107, fueled by the argument that the standard deck of many things didn't fit the Ravenloft atmosphere, we were introduced to a Tiaroka base replacement, the Tiaroka of many things. Of course, as this was both the time of old school role playing and the Ravenloft campaign setting, where DMs were encouraged to railroad and pick on their players, the Tiaroka is essentially one giant fuck you to any player who picks it up, and it should go without saying that if you spring this item on your players, you likely deserve whatever they do to you. With the backstory of being created by the dying curse of a Vistani seer who was murdered by one customer after she confessed he was doomed, the Tiaroka of many things carries far less power, and far more pain, than its standard cousin. The Tiaroka of many things has a 5% chance that it will disappear when a card is drawn. It is immune to the normal chaos controlling abilities of some kits, such as jesters and wild mages, but a pure-blooded Vistani has a 50% chance of being able to control what card is drawn whenever anybody draws a card from the deck in their presence. Half Vistani can do the same, but their muddied blood means they only have a 10% chance of succeeding at controlling the drawn card. This deck only activates when a card is drawn from it to test the future, and the effect of the drawn cards targets whoever is getting their future told. This means you can actually use this Tiaroka to curse your enemies, but you've got to trick them into agreeing to let you tell their future first. On top of this, the Tiaroka of many things carries a curse. Any character who carries the cards for a day or more must save versus wisdom willpower to keep from drawing a card to tell somebody's future, theirs, or otherwise. Each failed save causes a -1 penalty on the next save, and also encourages them to draw more cards. Voluntary draws don't inflict this save penalty, and transferring ownership of the deck negates the curse. They have to transfer the whole deck. As for the cards themselves, the wizard, gain +2 intelligence, suffer -1 strength. The rogue, gain +2 dexterity, suffer -1 wisdom. The priest, gain +2 wisdom, suffer -1 charisma. The warrior, gain +2 strength, suffer -1 intelligence. The horseman, feet mutate to look like hooves, but 2/day you can run at triple your normal speed for constitution score minutes without suffering any penalty. The broken one. You are feebler-minded, and even if cured by heal, restoration, or wish, you permanently lose 1d4 int and 1d4 wis. The hangman. At the next settlement you enter, you will be accused of murder, with evidence that points to you and a compulsion that will cause you to believe you are guilty within 2d4 days. You are not guilty, but your party will have to prove your innocence. The beast. You develop physical traits reminiscent of those classically associated with being a werewolf, such as increased hairiness and elongated canines. These changes are purely cosmetic, but will cause problems. The ghost, you immediately age 5d4 years. The marionette, you are immediately possessed by an odom. The raven, you gain eerie jet black eyes and unnaturally pale skin, which inflicts a -2 charisma penalty. You can foretell if any stranger you meet is going to die within the next 48 hours, which is indicated by a spectral raven, which only you can see, sitting on the doomed individual's shoulder. You lose this foresight if you somehow prevent a destined death, but the transformation is permanent. The Esper, you gain a wild talent from the telepathy school, or an Esp spell-like ability, if you don't want to muck around with psionics. You must use this at least 1/day, or it starts switching on randomly and at inconvenient times. The Innocent, you will automatically pass your next powers check. The Dungeon, you vanish into an unknown prison, leaving behind all your stuff, exactly as per the deck of many things card of the same name. The Mists, you are swallowed by the mists and carried off to some random spot in the demiplane of dread. The Dark Lord, you immediately suffer a failed powers check, and the Dark Lord of your current domain becomes aware of your present location. The Temptress, you are automatically charmed by the next sexually attractive person you see. The Artifact, you immediately gain a powerful, but probably cursed, magic item. Diaclave. In Exalted, a diaclave is an ornate, enormous blade made from an alloy of one of the magical materials. They are enchanted to be lighter in the hand of their attuned wielder than they really are. Each diaclave is a unique wonder, with a name, and is treated by its exalted bearer as a treasured friend. Unfortunately, this hasn't always been represented in the rules. A diaclave isn't much more than a +2 sword equivalent in the earlier editions, with little variation from one to the next. Many players, and NPCs, didn't bother naming their weapons. You had a Jade Diaclave, speed 4 ACC 3 dam 6 stroke 2 L def 2 attune 5, same as all the others. The book on artifacts gave guidelines on rating artifact powers, but gave little advice on combining them, even as it gave examples of diaclaves with extra powers. There was some effort in the Infernals book to introduce additional enchantments to place on an artifact weapon, chip damage on a parry, ignoring hardness, being more deadly at night, even having their own charms. That idea got expanded on in 3rd edition, where every artifact weapon is given its own unique charms called evocations, solving the uniqueness problem at last. Diaclave is, specifically, the term for swords of this nature. The general term is artifact weapon. For axes, you have Grimclivers, for maces and hammers you have Goramauls, bows are power bows, and a few others. Diaclaves are the most iconic, though, in the way that swords usually are. They uniquely have several subtypes, short diaclaves, grand diaclaves, reaper diaclaves, etc. Diaclaves contribute greatly to the weeaboo reputation of Exalted. A pair of cute girls in kimonos duking it out with swords bigger than they are is very much an Exalted's aesthetic. Excalibur. Excalibur is the legendary sword of King Arthur, sometimes attributed with magical powers or associated with the rightful sovereignty of Great Britain, or Kieland if you're using Greyhawk's World of Oath. Sometimes Excalibur and the Sword in the Stone, the proof of Arthur's lineage, are said to be the same weapon, but in most versions they are considered separate. The sword was associated with the Arthurian legend very early. In many versions, Excalibur's blade was engraved with phrases on opposite sides, take me up and cast me away, or similar. In addition, when Excalibur was first drawn, in the first battle testing Arthur's sovereignty, its blade blinded his enemies. Excalibur was given to Arthur by the Lady of the Lake sometime after he began to reign. She calls the sword Excalibur, that is to say as cut steel. Some believe that the Lady of the Lake is Maeahin the Shield Maiden. The challenge of drawing a sword from a stone, the proof of Arthur's lineage, also appears in the Arthurian legends of Galahad, whose achievement of the task indicates that he is destined to find the Holy Grail. Curiously, Excalibur is not a particularly magical sword by the standards of legendary magical swords. Besides being very shiny, it's really just a very sturdy, well-made weapon. Where its true power comes from is its scabbard, which was said in the original Arthurian legends to be able to either prevent bleeding or reduce the severity of injuries. Excalibur on the tabletop. As one of the classic public domain fantasy weapons, up there with Durandal, Joyce and Cusanagi, Excalibur can be found in many forms in many different words of vidya, literature and of course RPGs. Generally speaking, it will be represented as a very powerful, well-nigh unbreakable broadsword which may have strict conditions for use. It is the weapon of a worthy knight, after all. Figurine of Wondrous Power. The Figurine of Wondrous Power is a magic item hailing from Dungeons and Dragons. Specifically, it is a type of magic item. Much like the iron stones, all figurines are small images of animals worked from a specific kind of material, and with the power to be transformed from tiny figurine into a magical animal companion when activated. These companions are loyal to their bearer, and often have some unique magical abilities of their own to offer. One of the most famous figurines is Guinevere, a female black panther whose figurine is made of onyx, and a lifelong companion of the rogue Drowdrizzt. Uniquely, her figurine serves to summon her from her home in the astral plane, rather than directly transforming into her. This gives her an unusual level of resilience compared to some other examples of her kind. In the Ravenloft setting, malevolent golems known as figurine golems present themselves as figurines of wondrous power to the uneducated, but secretly work to harm and ultimately kill their owner and everyone around them. No tabletop RPG is complete without beautiful models on the table, and the best place to get models is from us. If you check the link below, we have everything you could need for your magical realm. Only the finest of big titty wafers here. But if you're not into models or don't play with models, we got you covered with subclasses such as the Gachimashi Wizards, the Simp Warlock and the North FC Fighter. Also, we have started selling 5th edition adventures, with our first one featuring Belle Delphine, the succubus that has poisoned the town's well and turned the villagers into simps. If any of that stuff sounds fun to you, go ahead and check the link below, but let's get back to the video. Frostrazer. Frostrazer is a powerful but obscure magical weapon from Dungeons and Dragons. This icy greatsword is essentially the embarrassing stepbrother to the famous white plume mountain weapons, Blackrazer, Wave and Whelm. Unlike its more famous kin, Frostrazer was not part of the original S2 module. Rather, it was added in the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons 2e module Return to White Plume Mountain, which expanded upon the original by exploring the wilderness outside of the titular dungeon Fastness. Covered on page 52 of the module, Frostrazer is part of the loot found by defeating the Mad Gnome Fighter Saprophis, Servitor of Mosmeter, a crazed and magically enhanced mold whim lurking in the depths of the dungeon. When Wizards of the Coast did their free White Plume Mountain Revisited adventure for 3.5, the requisite notes from Return to WPM were made into a free web enhancement, complete with converting Frostrazer into a weapon of legacy. Of course, with the loss of all those articles, about the only source for that web enhancement now is on Drivethrug. Perhaps part of the issue with Frostrazer's obscurity may stem from the fact that its powers can be a little complicated. Frostrazer's unique shtick is that the weapon is made of a single mass of solid, jagged ice, and on a hit, there's a chance a shard will break off in the victim's body and start sucking the life from them to augment its wielder. Exactly how this worked differs from edition to edition. In Add&D, Frostrazer is a +3 greatsword of Nevermelting that inflicts 1d10+3 damage on a hit, or 3d6+3 damage on a hit versus large or bigger creatures. Supernaturally light for its size, it can be wielded proficiently by any creature that is less than huge sized, so long as they have at least one proficiency point in any sort of sword. On a successful hit roll of a 17+, a 6-inch long shard of ice breaks off in the wound and starts draining the energy from the victim. This has no effect on undead or non-living creatures like constructs. A creature can try to pull the shard out by forfeiting all actions for that turn on a successful save versus death magic. They manage to rip it out of their body. Otherwise, it melts away after 10 rounds of draining life essence, at least, usually. There is a 1% chance that a shard won't melt away after it's pulled out or that time is up. If that happens, there's another 1% chance it retains some of its original magic, becoming a +2 dagger of unmelting ice. Additionally, creatures killed by either the draining effects of a Frostraza shard or just a stroke of the sword freeze solid. This means they can be shattered into pieces, just like victims of a flesh to stone effect, which will make it impossible to raise them from the dead. Exactly how the Frostraza's drain effect manifests depends on the scoring number of the hit. The higher the number, the deeper it was driven, and so the more life energy it can drain. A shard planted by a roll of 17 drains 1 hit point per round and transfers it to Frostraza's wielder. On an 18, it instead transfers 3 hit points per round. On a 19, the shard instead drains 1 point of strength every 2 rounds and transfers it, although this can't boost the wielder's strength higher than 24. Finally, a shard planted on a roll of 20 drains 1 level or hit dice from the victim and, on the 10th round, has a 50% chance of draining a second level hit die before it melts. Lost levels are transferred to the wielder, who gains appropriate increases in Thac 0 and attacks round. Stolen hit points, strengthened levels can boost Frostraza's wielder above their normal limits. However, all stolen benefits will fade after 30 minutes, although only excess, higher than max, hit points vanish. Those who run into Frostraza and survive will regain drained hit points and strength at a rate of 1 per turn, but lose their levels permanently. The AD&D version of Frostraza is known for not being sapient, unlike Karatis' more famous Trinity of Weepus. It may possibly be intelligent, but if so, it's kept its status a secret. The 3.5 version is a different kettle of blood entirely. This version of Frostraza wasn't created by Karatis at all, rather, a nameless archmage crafted the blade by impaling an ancient whim of a white dragon with an enormous icicle stalactite, knocking it from the roof and impaling the beast through the heart before using its blood and magic to shape the icicle into a massive, crystalline blade of never-melting ice. He did this to create a superior weapon that could be used in his war against an Efreet Pasha. Unfortunately for him, his trusted general was actually working for said Efreet, and promptly stabbed him in the back with it. Literally. After a long string of mishaps that cemented its powers, it vanished when an adventurer took it to White Plume Mountain and failed to return. Frostraza the Legacy Weapon is a +1 greatsword that will only allow a character with the improved critical greatsword feat to wield it. There are 3 rituals you must complete in order to unlock its full power. Firstly, piercing the heart. Kill a foe with a single blow by stabbing them through the heart with Frostraza, then perform a 1-hour long ritual whilst the sword is still buried in their heart. Second, bathing in the waters of origin. Find the icy cavern where the sword was created, and then jump into the freezing waters with sword in hand. Swim around it there for an hour, come out with at least 50% of your hit points left, and it will have completed its second ritual. Finally, you must undertake the Vengeance of Garrus, which requires you to find a dragon that is a direct blood descendant of the white dragon originally murdered to create Frostraza and kill them with it. As this dragon has to be at least 800 years old to count, good luck. Once properly empowered, Frostraza's properties start manifesting at 5th level, when it gains the implanted shard ability. On a critical hit against a creature that isn't immune to such strikes, a shard breaks off and begins burrowing into their flesh, inflicting 1 point of damage per round. Digging this out requires 1 full round action per round that the shard has been implanted. Frostraza can only have 3 shards actively burrowing into one or more victims at a time. Needless to say, the bulk of Frostraza's powers stem around augmenting these ice shards. Enfeebling Shard, gained at level 6, allows you to cast a Ray of Enfeeblement on a shard's host as a swift action 1/day, 3/day after reaching level 10. Additionally, whilst the shard is implanted, a critical strike against any foe lets you zap the shard's host with another free Ray of Enfeeblement. Wounding Shard, gained at level 15, bumps up the implanted shard by causing it to inflict 1 point of constitution damage per round as well. Life-stealing shard, gained at level 16, functions the same as enfeebling shard, but affects the host with an innovation spell, CL10. This can be used 2/day, plus 1 extra time each time Frostraza causes a critical hit. Death shard, the pinnacle of this tray, is gained at level 20 and works the same way as enfeebling and life-stealing shard, except now it can cast Finger of Death, CL14, 1/day plus 1s per critical hit. In addition to those powers, Frostraza buffs itself up to being a plus 2 greatsword at level 7 and then a plus 3 greatsword at level 12, gains the winter warding, resist energy, cold, 1/day at CL8, power at level 8 in the chill of the north, ice storm at CL12 3/day, power at level 18. Additionally, Frostraza doesn't adopt its true form of being made of solid ice until it hits 11th level. Holy Avenger. A Holy Avenger is a type of sword in D&D, sought after by paladins. Through a Holy Avenger, a paladin may use his paladin implemented powers with the sword's enchantment bonus on top of having a weapon that can harm almost any monster in hand. Such weapons are the stuff of legends across the multiverse and only one dedicated body and soul to his cause can hope to draw and wield it. Holy Avengers have changed a bit over the editions even though the paladin's toy concept remained. It used to be a unique type of two-handed sword in AD&D, and a specific longsword in 3E. In 4th edition it became a weapon enchantment. Now it's back, as an official and Adventurer's League legal magic item in the DMG for 5th edition, restricted to paladins, with a legendary rating and no resale cost. This is a very nice item for charisma paladins. Icons of Simeon. The Icons of Simeon are minor artifact hair magical items from the Dungeons & Dragons world of Kryn. Sacred relics of the Great Temple of Ister, the Icons of Simeon were lost during the Cataclysm. In fact, they had actually been borrowed by a Kenda named Ferret Snitch Whistle several days earlier. Having stumbled into the World Serpent Inn, the cursed Ferret now sends doomed adventuring parties to the last 3 days of Ister over and over again, seeking to find all 5 so that he can repent for his crime and be granted freedom from his curse. The icons consist of 5 plates of precious metal, each 1/2 inch thick, 5 inches square, and with a small hole in the center of one edge, allowing them to be strung together on a chain and worn like an amulet. Multiple icons can be worn on the same chain, and so their effects as an amulet stack. Each icon is emblazoned with a metallic dragon of the same type as the metal it is made from. The icons all have hardness 10 and 30 hit points. The brass icon grants plus 2 dexterity. The bronze icon grants plus 2 wisdom. The copper icon grants plus 2 charisma. The gold icon grants a plus 2 luck bonus on all saving throws. The silver icon can cast disguise self at will on the user. In addition to their individual effects, the icons of Simeon can be assembled into a box-like shape. 3 times per day, this box can be filled with water and it will respond by transforming that water into holy water. Additionally, once per day, a single individual can place their hand in the box and confess their sins to receive the effects of an atonement spell. The icons were introduced in issue number 351 of Dragon Magazine for the 3.5 edition ruler set. Ironstone. Ironstones are a magical item native to the Dungeons & Dragons game. Derived from similar trinkets that appeared in the Dying Earth novels of Jack Vance, a sea fantasy series that Gary Gygax absolutely loved, ironstones are magical stones that a bearer induces to orbit around their head. In older editions, ironstones were unique amongst head slot magical items in that they could stack, and a truly powerful individual could have a dozen or more of these stones orbiting them at the same time. A good thing, since the last tally of iron stones puts them in the area of 154 varieties. Later editions generally tended to cut this aspect down, to avoid power gaming if nothing else. Despite what you may think, there was no specific individual called Iron in the D&D mythos until late AD&D 2E era, when Forgotten Realms Arcane Age series gave us Netheri's Arcanist Congenio Iron. Being more or less magical counterpart of Leonard of Quirm, initially he tried to call his new toys Congenio's Pebbles. Then Wizards of the Coast decided that it made sense to use this name as Iron, the 4E goddess of knowledge, skill and prophecy. Because the new developers don't bother to read old lore and the job of continuity editors apparently was abolished before creation of a proper database. Or maybe they just don't care. Iron stones come in a variety of distinctive shapes and colors, with each different combination of shape and color providing a new unique power. For the grand list of every iron stone that existed up until 5th edition, TG has got you covered. Rod of Wonder. The Rod of Wonder is an artifact from Dungeons & Dragons that does either something benevolent, malevolent, or ambivalent for the person using it. The effect is always random and usually chosen by rolling a d100 and looking at a table to determine the effect. There are many different tables, all with different effects, out there with which to refer to. Also, some choose to make their own tables. Some hilarious effects include: mass invisibility affects every creature within 900 feet of the wielder. Reverse gravity affects 150 feet. Comma centered on the rod wielder. The most recent adversary the wielder killed that has an equal or greater number of hit dice is returned to life at the exact location where it was slain, and it immediately becomes obsessed with evening the score. Wielder is teleported to the location where he was at exactly one day ago. Any other random effect your DM can think of. Various editions of D&D call it the Wand of Wonder, including the current one, which in that case is a typical magic item instead of an artifact. Although functionally the same, the practical difference is a wand can be pointed, whereas a rod is something you hold in your fist and wave in a vague direction. Oh, and wands can be broken, which releases all the remaining charges. May the gods have mercy on your character's soul. It is called the Staff of Chaos in Dungeon Crawl. Here, it's a weapon that does random things to its target, like for instance turning them into a mermaid, or a berserker. Scepter of Aphelimon. Nemaspasis Spadger Discussion Projections for a Dirty Tea Story. The Scepter of Aphelimon is an artifact tier magic item in Dungeons & Dragons, which serves as the physical symbol of the pact between Jathianki and Red Dragons that was engineered by Jith. Mentioned in passing in Jathianki-related sourcer books, the Scepter of Aphelimon is detailed in Dungeon Magazine number 100, where it is one of two artifacts in the possession of Larkith Kalvidai. Described simply as ruby-encrusted and dragon-shaped, it was presented to Vlarkithai by its namesake, Aphelimon, consort of Shiamat, eons ago. It is the physical symbol of the pact between Jith and Shiamat, and if it were to be destroyed, it would instantly sunder that pact, resulting in the Red Dragons abandoning their Jithianki allies except where personally motivated to stay loyal. Likewise, should the pact be broken, as it is in Scales of War, then the scepter will lose its powers. What powers are those? Well, for a start, all Red Dragons within a half mile of the scepter must succeed at a DC 35 will save or be affected by a dominate monster spell cast by a 30th level caster, which compels them to obey whoever's holding the scepter. Additionally, once per week, the bearer can use the scepter to create a gate that summons a red dragon of the very old age category. This dragon must make the aforementioned save versus domination, but even if it resists, is still affected by the normal compulsions of all gated creatures. Finally, whoever bears the scepter of Aphelimon is immune to fire and to fear. The scepter has 60 hit points, and can only be damaged by the claws of Bahamut, or a chosen vassal Theraph, a magic weapon with a bane, evil dragons, enchantment, or by the cold breath weapon of a good aligned silver dragon. The Belt of Champions. The Belt of Champions is a magic item to be used in D&D. It finds its creation in 3.5e, but may as well be used in 5e. The belt is described as a brass belt similar to the belts used as WWE wrestling, so useless and ornate to the point that even Slaanesh would say it's a bit too much. The only real function of the belt is to allow a barbarian to have a lawful alignment. Fluff. When a potential champion is born, there is celebration in Valhalla. As a result of this excessive celebration on top of the usual brawling, feasting and drinking a brass tankard, strips of leather and cutlery fall from the tables and plummet down to the mortal planes. The impact of the items on the ground cause the metal to flatten and melt over the leather, forming the belt. Then as the cutlery impacts the hot brass, Words of song are inscribed in 5 languages: Draconic, Orcish, Human, Elven and Dwarven. True champions proudly display ferocity, strength, skill at arms, honesty and loyalty in all challenges of life. Double quote. It is said that once the potential champion finds the path of the barbarian, they subconsciously pick up a second language based on which sub-phrase of the belt they uphold the most. Those that pick up Draconic often are boastful and desire all eyes on them and their pride. Those that pick up Orcish are fierce and value strength above all. Those that refine their common language will often be more dignified and measured. Those that pick up Elvish will never tell a lie. And those that pick up Dwarvish will always accept any challenge. A potential champion will be led to their belt through their actions. The closer the potential champion remains to the words of the song, displaying their strength and skill while upholding themselves and those around them, to remain honest and accepting and calling out challenges to strong foes, the sooner they will find their belt. Once a potential champion finds their belt, they are deemed worthy enough to travel to Valhalla should they die. The belt becomes bound to the champion's soul. However, the belt is a constant reminder of the champion's status, and the words of the song as a fragment of their soul is infused into the belt. Thus, whenever they strays too far from the path, i.e. making the conscious decision to lie purely for personal gain, not displaying their losses as equally as proud as their victories or declining a challenge of their skill at arms, the belt will inflict punishment on the champion, most commonly a numb feeling in the fingertips or bad dreams reminding them of their failures. Sometimes it goes as far as dulling the sensation of pleasure derived from food, drinks, smell or physical acts, making life dull and bland. Truly immovable rod. The truly immovable rod, also called the universal stalepoint rod, is a meme derived from a FarTGUI's story about how his dickish DM applied some very dodgy, but accurate if it was the real world and not the D&D world, physics to an immovable rod, judging that it remained immutably fixed in the universe while the planet they were on was moving, and thus setting it off, relative to the players, at several thousand miles an hour when activated. The very same FarTGUI later used an immovable rod as a siege weapon to destroy a castle, pissing off his DM. It was considered that, since every celestial body is moving very quickly, anybody who placed such an immovable rod would never see it again, as their system left the stationary rod floating in the void. If this had happened a lot, there could be any number of immovable rods out there, simply biding their time until some unsuspecting and unfortunate planet happens to pass through the same region of space and clang. Asterisk. What the fuck was that? Oddly enough, this exact thing happened in Lucifer's Hammer, a book written by Larry Niven and Jerry Pennell in 1977, when a space station orbiting the Earth was suddenly hit. Dickish GMS who wished to avoid such shenanigans should utilize a setting that is not based on planets, but instead, on an infinite plane of existence consisting solely of land extending in all four prime directions, and without proper space as we know it in this crapfest universe that we type this shit in. Or to use a Ptolemyan universe, with a planet in the center of the universe that doesn't move or spin, and sun, moon, stars and planets orbiting around it. Only then will the immovable rod function as advertised, thus avoiding the collision of physics and magic, and consequently, rendering all attempted castle demolitions using this method as invalid schlep comedy and copycat antics to be derided and punished with style. A final alternative is to claim it's relative to the nearest celestial body, or anchored to a manosphere Alashadoran. Why this wouldn't work? Einstein's theory of general relativity, as well as many of the theories it superseded, tells us that there can never be a true fixed point in the universe, as all movement is based on the observer. For example, you can cause a mountain to move simply by sailing past it on a moving object. To your perspective, you're sitting still, and the mountain is moving. This also applies to planets and entire star systems. Why this would work, but not how you expected it to. Relativity aside, the only way an object could be immovable would be if it had infinite mass. Any object of infinite mass would subject everything in the universe to infinite g-forces, thereby pulling everything in the universe toward itself at the speed of light. This would be extremely bad for anyone trying to use the immovable rod as a weapon. The good news is that, since these g-forces are infinite, They are equal regardless of distance from the immovable rod, which means there are no tidal forces and no spaghettification. People will live long enough to be crushed into neutronium instead. In short, the moment you activate the rod, the universe as you know it ceases to exist. You won? Well, actually only your local galaxy would be at any risk for the next million years, since intergalactic space is so huge that even rushing toward the immovable rod at the speed of light will take ages. Actually. 1. The original DM who started this didn't read the rules clearly, because normal immovable rods can, in fact, be moved via the application of 8,000 pounds of force. As soon as the force being exerted against them drops under 8,000 pounds, they stop moving. This implies that they are being kept in place not by inertia, but by some kind of cosmological, gravitational, or magnetic drag. 2. A comment on the original Thray mentioned that truly immovable rods would also be indestructible. If any part of the rod can be damaged, it implies the molecules are being broken apart, dented in, etc. Moved. If the rod is immovable, then the whole rod should be immovable on a molecular scale. As a corollary of this, immovable rods also maintain a temperature of absolute zero, at least relative to the outside world, if not internally. 3. Immovable rods are stated to be made out of metal. Many metals become superconductors when brought near absolute zero. Therefore, the metal rod part of the truly immovable rods are probably superconductors when activated. 4. Many planets have magnetic fields. Some of these magnetic fields are much stronger than Earth's. If you'd like to know what happens when you bring a superconductor and a magnetic field near each other, look up magnetic flux pinning or quantum locking on YouTube. Useless items. TG is a massive hive mind of activity, heresy, and also a devout follower to the Emperor. Double heresy, and so can come up with some amazingly useless items. Here are a few with more to be added later. The list. Shower cap of singing. Gives large bonus to singing, but only if you wear it while showering. Teapot of tea time. A teapot that will, every day at 4 o'clock, whistle loudly and make piping hot tea, regardless of where it is. Backpack, for instance. There is no way to prevent this. It's good tea though. Unbending spoon. A spoon which cannot be bent, broken, or deformed, except if used to scoop ice cream. Objectional wrapper. A wrapper that can only be opened by its owner. Can fit one small sweet candy. Book of constant incorrect multidimensionism. A book that is always upside down, even if you turn it over or two people look at it from different sides. Cheating chalk. Chalk that can't be erased, but disappears after 10 seconds. Trippy paint. A paintbrush that changes color at random. Paint type 2. Gloves of invisibility. Yes, they turn your hands invisible amazingly. Tiny ever-burning candle. A tiny candle that can never be extinguished. Can never be stowed away as its flame could light up a standard backpack. So place it in a glass jar, as it won't extinguish. Permanent light that can be used underwater. This has so many applications. Comma, this is not useless. Blindfold of limited invisibility. Renders the wearer completely invisible for a random amount of time, providing he doesn't remove the blindfold to check or see where he is going. Wait, wouldn't this be useful for those with tremorsense? Close bracket. The edge of decay. Despite the awesome name, this is really just an enchanted kitchen knife with a 6-inch blade. When used to slice any food item, the food magically transmutes itself to a state of being just about to go bad. Bread becomes slightly stale, cheese is a touch moldy, vegetable a limp, and meat tastes slightly off. This is the case no matter if the ingredient was fresh or if it's the desiccated husk of moldy remains years old. The sliced food is always safe to eat, but never tasty. Potentially useful, or at least unuseless, if it renders rotting food safe to eat. Close bracket. A four parchment of the fiend. A curse parchment that erases everything except profanities and obscene illustrations. Abusive monitor. A computer monitor that monitors its user and talks shit about them when they are not looking. Aromatic pen. A pen that allows you to write in the air, but does not let you treat the air like a solid surface. The pen just leaves long squiggly lines in a 3D space and is only potentially understandable from the right angle. The writing vanishes after 30 seconds and the pen needs refilling very frequently. Portable political propaganda. An MP3 player which, when playing any song, replaces the vocals with those of three random members of Parliament. Magical ring of detect darkness. When it detects darkness, it glows. This creates light, so it is no longer dark, so the ring stops glowing. But then it's dark, so it starts glowing again. Essentially, it becomes a strobe light. Orb of odd sight. Staring into it 4D6x10 minutes shows you an event happening 3 days in the future, in a different universe. However, nothing will allow you to travel to this universe. Electric eye. An enchanted eye that can see right through you, with an undetectable stare. It can see right through you, but the person you're viewing with it doesn't know it's there. Codex. 7th edition. A series of books about leading armies which when read by an army leader gives the leader's army radioactive aids. Wave. Wave is one of three infamous magical weapons introduced to Dungeons & Dragons in the first edition Advanced Dungeons & Dragons Module S2, White Plume Mountain. Alongside its siblings Black Razor and Whelm, this weapon has managed to make an appearance in every single edition of the game, from 1st through to 5th, an honor that can't be shared with their oft-forgotten sibling, Frost Razor. Crafted to honor a particular sea god, which one varies depending on edition, this enchanted trident has a lot of powers and has varied quite considerably over the editions. When it appeared in 1st edition, in the infamous giant crab in a safe bubble in a sea of boiling water chamber, Wave was an intelligent true neutral trident plus 3 with 14 intelligence and 20 ego, determined to convert everybody to worship of its patron sea god, with Poseidon suggested as the default. This version of Wave had the combined powers of a trident of fish commanding and a trident of warning. Possessed the ability to find water, granted its bearer the ability to breath water and act underwater, could function as a cube of force, and one final power, dehydrate. On a to hit roll of 20, it sucked vital fluids from the victim's body, causing them to take first the initial damage, and then to halve their remaining hit points. In 2nd edition, Wave was moved outside of White Plume Mountain, hidden in the possession of Thingizzard, the Witch of the Fence. This version of Wave, now a neutral evil trident plus 3, was as smart and egotistical as ever, but had lost its proselytizing nature. Now, all it cared about was staying the hell out of Caractus' hands. It retained its dehydrate power, unchanged from 1st edition, and combined the powers of a trident of fish command with a trident of warning, although it had learned to affect swamp creatures as well as water creatures. It could also function as a cube of force, with 9 charges usable per day. Finally, it could grant the bearer water breathing and a swimming rate of 15 once per day. The 3.5 version of Wave, a weapon of legacy, was covered in the White Plume Mountain Revisited Adventure, a free upload done by WOTC, but now lost with their old website. Luckily, TG gets shit done and tracked the stats down. Wave, the weapon of legacy, is, initially, a plus 1 trident that can only be wielded by someone of any neutral alignment and with a barb or plus 2. To unlock its full powers, you must complete 3 ritual trials, mastery over sea, defeat an aquatic subtype creature whose CR equals or exceeds your level, raise the Asterion, find the sunken shipwreck of the Asterion and bring its figurehead back above the waves, and reverence to the Sea Queen. Seek out Thunderforge Island, enter its temple to the Sea Queen, and perform an 8-hour rite of worship in her honor. Once this is done, Wave starts to activate its powers. In addition to increasing in general strength, becoming a plus 2 trident at level 11, a plus 3 trident at level 16, a plus 4 trident at level 18 and a plus 5 trident at level 20, it unlocks a bevy of special powers. As a 5th level weapon, it gives you the stupidly named warning ability. You can use a standard action to sense the presence of all aquatic creatures within 60 feet. Also, you ignore the damage reduction of any creature with the aquatic subtype. At level 8, you gain a permanent water breathing, CL10, effect so long as you are holding Wave. At level 10, Wave awakens and becomes a sentient weapon within 16, Wis 10, Char 16, an ego 10, 12 at LLTH level, 14 at 17th level. It has hearing and dark vision in a range of 60 feet. At level 13, it grants underwater vision. When underwater, you can see 5 times farther than the prevailing water and light conditions would normally allow, and ignore the miss chance when attacking invisible creatures in the water. At level 15, Aquatic Allies lets you summon an Elasmosaurus, large water elemental, adult Tajanida, orca whale, ichthyosaur or large monstrous crab once per day. At level 17, Fish Command lets you make a charm monster spell, CL 15. DC is the higher of 16 or 14 plus your charm modifier, 3/day that only targets creatures with the aquatic subtype. Finally, at level 19, it gains the Dehydrate power, which lets it cast Horrid Wilting, CL 15. DC is the higher of 22 or 18 plus your charm modifier, 1/day. In 4th edition, Wave was upgraded to the role of Paragon Terra artifact weapon, located in the plane below, a source book on the elemental chaos. This version of Wave is explicitly devoted to the goddess Melora and her exarch Sekla, and many of its powers key off of facing down heretics, aquatic or elemental creatures that do not worship either Melora or one of Melora's exarchs. It is a +3 magic trident that does increased critical damage, +3d10, against heretics, grants the bearer a swim speed equal to their land speed, prevents them from being surprised by heretics, and has an encounter power that lets them, as a minor action, ignore cover and concealment when attacking heretics until the end of their next turn. As you've probably figured, Wave appreciates if its bearer worships Melora or one of her exarchs, +2 concordance, and is gladdened whenever you slay a heretic, +1 concordance per day. It's angered if you spare a heretic, -1 concordance. Outrage if you attack one of Melora's own aquatic elemental servitors, -2 concordance, and infuriated to be wielded by a heretic, -4 concordance. When satisfied, Wave grants its bear the aquatic subtype and lets them grant all allies within 10 squares the water breathing tray until the end of the encounter. When pleased, it becomes a +4 weapon, deals +1d10 damage against heretics, and prevents you from being flanked by heretics. On the other hand, when unhappy, you lose your protection against being ambushed by heretics, and when it's angry, you lose your swim speed and it downgrades to a +2 weapon. If at least satisfied when moving 1, it leaves its bearer with a permanent swim speed equal to their land speed. Finally, the 5th edition rendition of Wave appears in the Dungeon Master's Guide. This sentient, Int 14, Wis 10, Chai 18, hearing and dark vision out to 120 feet, +3 trident can only be wielded by someone sworn to a sea god. It retains its dehydrate ability, now manifesting as the victim of a critical hit taking necrotic damage equal to half of their hit point maximum, and still functions as a hybrid of trident of fish command and weapon of warning. It can act as a cube of force when called upon, and bestows the benefits of a cap of water breathing on its wielder. Finally, it can speak with animals to all aquatic creatures, and use its telepathy to involve its wielder in the conversation. Whelm. Whelm is one of 3 infamous magical weapons introduced to Dungeons & Dragons in the 1st edition Advanced Dungeons & Dragons Module S2, White Plume Mountain. Alongside its siblings Black Razor and Wave, this weapon has managed to make an appearance in every single edition of the game, from 1st through to 5th. An honor that can't be shared with their oft-forgotten sibling, Frostrazor. Perhaps the most humble of the 3 white plume weapons, Whelm is an enchanted throwing hammer of dwarven make, infamously guarded by the vampire Tenmyar. Simple and straightforward, Whelm tends to exemplify dwarfish values, as best as those are defined in their edition. In 1st edition, Whelm is an intelligent +3 hammer, +5 hammer for dwarfs, within 15 and ego 18 whose driving purpose is to slay all of the monstrous enemies of dwarfdom, trolls, giants and goblinoids. Whelm can detect the presence of gold, gems and goblins, and has the powers of a hammer of stunning, 1/day, pound the ground to create a 60-foot shockwave that forces up to 45 hit points worth of enemies to save versus spell or be stunned for 1d4 rounds. Additionally, a dwarf wielder can throw the hammer 150 feet as a ranged attack 3/day, with it returning each time it is thrown. However, it bears a minor curse and inflicts severe agoraphobia on the bearer, causing them to take a -2 penalty when not fighting in an enclosed space or at night. When second edition came along and Whelm reappeared in Return to White Plume Mountain, it hadn't changed much. It was still a sentient +3/+5 for dwarfs, magic hammer that retained its former traits, but the precise mechanics had been tweaked. Now its int was 14 and its ego was 20, and it would try to force its wielder to go goblin hunting if they failed to kill at least one goblinoid, giant or troll a month. It could still be thrown 150 feet 3 times per day and unleash a stunning 60 feet shockwave. Up to 7 HD of enemies now had to save versus spell or be stunned for 1d4 rounds, but these powers weren't racial restricted. Its sensory range to detect gold, gems and goblinoids was now clarified to be 60 feet. It also gained a new power. On a critical hit, a large or bigger creature would take +20 damage and a medium or smaller creature would be hit with a disintegrate spell. However, its agoraphobia, now specified as a penalty to attack rolls, saving throws, and proficiency checks, was more severed. You see, for each consecutive 24-hour period without spending at least 8 hours inside or underground, the penalty increased by a further -1, maxing out at a -5 penalty. Like all of the White Mountain weapons, Whelm received its 3.5 update in White Plume Mountain Revisited, which is now all but impossible to find due to the collapse of the old WOTC internet archives. Luckily, TG gets shit done and so you see and find it here. As with the other three White Plume weapons, Whelm is treated as a weapon of legacy in 3.5, although it's honestly the most underwhelming of them all, which is saying something when WoW's pre-built weapons are known to be pretty bad. Not only does it only reach up to level 16, it only has two legacy rituals, against the giants, knowingly and willingly enter battle against a giant type creature in an encounter where the L exceeds your party level by at least 1, and against the goblins. Slay a group of goblinoids with at least 30 HD collectively, during which you defeat a hostile goblinoid with a CR at least equal to your character level. This version of Whelm can only be used by a dwarf character with a barb of +3 and weapon proficiency, Warhammer. Starting its existence as a +1 Warhammer, it upgrades to a +1 Giant Bane Warhammer at 6th level, a +1 Giant and Goblin Bane Warhammer at 11th level, and then increasing in potency to +2 at level 13 and +3 at level 16. Its initial special ability at level 5 is Sense Giants, which functions as a permanent detect evil spell that detects giant type creatures within 60 feet. At 8th level, it can cast Locate Objects 3/day, and gain Sense Goblinoids, which is just like Sense Giants, but for goblinkin. Finally, at 10th level, it becomes a sentient item with a 60-foot sensory range, hearing and dark vision, int 16, wis 16, char 10, and ego 14, increasing to 15 at 14th level and to 16 at 16th level. Because of Whelm's long history with Ktenmire, it appeared as a Paragon Tear artifact weapon in 4th edition's Open Grave, Secrets of the Undead Sourcebook. This +3 magic Warhammer has increased critical hit damage against creatures bigger than medium sized, +3d10 instead of +3d6, grants +2 to perception checks, can be used as a heavy thrown weapon with range 5/10 due to teleporting back to the wielder's hand, and grants 3 paladin powers as bonus attacks, Valiant Strike, Thunder Smite and Bloodied Retribution. Needless to say, it prefers a dwarven wielder, +2 concordance. But so long as you keep killing goblins, trolls and giants, it'll be happy. +1 concordance on any day you kill one. On the other hand, going without at least one such kill a week will tick it off. -1 concordance, and it will be extremely pissed if taken up by a goblin, troll or giant. -5 concordance. When satisfied, it boosts its perception bonus to +3 and grants the paladin's turn the tight daily power. When happy, it increases to a +4 Warhammer, crit damage goes up to +4d6 +4d10, grants +2 initiative, and gives you the fighter's dragon's fangs daily power. When unsatisfied, It inflicts a -2 penalty to initiative and to all attack rolls against creatures that aren't goblins, trolls or giants, and this applies even if you're not wielding Whelm. When truly angered, it drops in power to a mere +2 weapon and the attack roll penalty increases to -5. When it moves on, if satisfied, it leaves a +3 Warhammer as a thank you. The most recent version of Whelm showed up in the Dungeon Master's Guide for D&D 5e. This artifact here +3 Warhammer can only be used by a dwarf. It still imposes its traditional agoraphobia, giving you disadvantage on attack rolls, saving throws and ability checks so long as you can see the daytime sky. It can be thrown 20 feet, which causes it to inflict +1d8 bludgeoning damage on a hit, +2d8 on a giant, and can be used to create a shockwave attack once per day. This forces a DC 15 constitution save for each creature on the ground of your choice within 60 feet, or else they're stunned for 1 minute or until they make their save. Its supernatural awareness makes the wielder automatically aware of secret concealed doors within 30 feet, and lets them cast either Detect Evil and Good or Locate Objects 1/day. Finally, its ascendant weapon, Int 15, Wis 12, Chuv 15, Hearing and Dark Vision to 120 feet, communicates telepathically, speaks Dwarvish, Giant and Goblin. Well guys, hope you enjoy today's video. We are going to assume you have if you have stayed to the end. Consider subscribing and clicking the notification bell if you really enjoyed it to stay up to speed with any and all new videos. Also check out the links below to our shop for some fat ass titties and our sponsor Rural, and be sure to use a promo code at checkout so they know we sent you and you'll get 10% off. And until next time.